Hello, I'm Aimee Edinger, Associate Professor in UC Irvine's Ayala School of Biological Sciences, and today I'm going to be discussing our recent paper in the Journal of Clinical Investigation, targeting cancer metabolism by simultaneously disrupting parallel nutrient access pathways. Projects in my lab are focused on understanding cancer cell metabolism and developing new strategies for limiting tumor cell growth. We're particularly interested in a class of molecules called sphingolipids, and these compounds control nutrient access by regulating nutrient transporter trafficking in organisms from yeast to man. In times of stress, eukaryotic cells produce sphingolipids like ceramide and phytosphingosine, triggering downregulation of transporters for glucose and amino acids. Reducing nutrient access starves cells into a hibernation-like state that allows them to survive a variety of kinds of environmental stress. And these natural compounds inspired us to design similar molecules with improved pharmacological properties that we could use to starve cancer cells to death. Cancer cells are hypersensitive to starvation. The oncogenes that drive tumor anabolism are constitutively in the on state, while the tumor suppressor genes that allow quiescence and catabolism are deleted. And this makes cancer cells very vulnerable to an attack on the supply wagons, the nutrient import pathways. In this JCI article, we provide direct evidence that cells expressing a single oncogene or lacking a single tumor suppressor are no longer able to make appropriate metabolic changes in the face of nutrient limitation. On the other hand, normal cells are metabolically flexible and switch to doing more oxidative phosphorylation under nutrient-limiting conditions. Basically, normal cells act like bears in the winter and go into a hibernation-like state when nutrients are scarce, while cancer cells continue to try and grow regardless of the environmental conditions. Thus, the therapeutic index for anti-cancer starvation agents comes not from differential expression of the target of these molecules, but from the difference in the response of normal and cancer cells to nutrient limitation. A compound discussed in this manuscript, 893, causes rapid downregulation of glucose and amino acid transporters similar to ceramide. Because it affects multiple nutrient import pathways, it's effective against cancers with different nutritional requirements. For example, colorectal cancer xenografts that are driven by RAS and autochthonous tumors in mice lacking P53 and P10 in the prostate are both sensitive to 893. These graphs show that 893 is extremely efficacious in prostate cancer. In this model system, we implant mouse prostate cancer epithelial cells subcutaneously in the flank of BLAK6 mice. And here you can see with the black line that tumors grow exponentially over time. When we treat mice with a low dose of 893, we see some inhibition of tumor growth, and that increases when we up the dose to 120 mg per kg 893. And it's important to point out, too, that we're giving the compound orally. So this is an orally bioactive drug. On the right, you can see a related autochthonous tumor model. So autochthonous means that tumors are forming in their natural location. So they'll have normal cells around them and also a more well-developed blood supply. So these tumors grow to be about a gram over the course of 4 to 5 months. But when mice are treated with 893, you see a dose-responsive inhibition of tumor growth. So 120 mg per kg reduces tumor mass by about 80%. And the impressive activity of 893 against prostate cancer was somewhat surprising given that prostate cancers are notoriously slow growing, not FDG PET positive, and don't really depend on glucose and amino acids in the media. Similarly, RAS-driven cancers should have been able to use autophagy or macropinocytosis to compensate for the loss of nutrient transporter expression when treated with 893. So what's going on? Well, basically there are four pathways by which cells acquire nutrients. There's amino acid and glucose transporters in the plasma membrane that allow these nutrients to enter cells. There's receptors for low-density lipoproteins that allow cholesterol and fatty acids to enter the cell. But in this case, the cells rely on the lysosome to release the nutrients from the LDL particles. Autophagy is a process by which cells recycle non-essential components to derive nutrients from internal sources when extracellular nutrients are limiting. And lastly, macropinocytosis is a non-selective uptake process by which large membrane ruffles form and non-specifically engulf extracellular material that's again degraded in the lysosome to things like amino acids. So three of these pathways rely on the lysosome for nutrient generation, and it turns out this is what makes 893 such an effective starvation agent. It not only triggers nutrient transporter loss, but it also blocks lysosomal fusion reactions with endosomes, autophagosomes, and macropinosomes by mislocalizing the phosphatidylinositol kinase, PIK5. So as a result of this block in lysosomal fusion, 893-treated cells fill with vacuoles, a really striking phenotype that we even see in tumors in vivo. Basically, because it blocks multiple pathways in parallel, 893 causes profound cellular starvation, explaining its activity in both RAS-driven tumors and prostate cancers with PTEN deletion. Here's an example of the profound cytoplasmic vacuolation that we see in cells treated with 893. Here you can see a control cell. These are HeLa cells. And when we treat them with 893, the cytoplasm fills with these phase-lucent vacuoles. One obvious question is, aren't the normal cells depending on autophagy to survive nutrient limitation? And the answer is yes. But normal cells also make adaptive changes in their metabolism that will decrease their nutrient requirements. In addition, 893 doesn't completely inhibit these pathways, and some nutrients are flowing into cells. Remarkably, when we treated animals with this compound for 3 months, there were no signs of toxicity. They looked like mice on a diet, not mice on chemotherapy. Both the CBC and chemistry panels were normal. There were no signs of liver or kidney toxicity and no bone marrow suppression. The intestinal crypts were indistinguishable between normal and treated mice. So why isn't this compound toxic? And I think the explanation is that drug levels are rising and falling in the plasma. So normal cells can tolerate a few hours of nutrient limitation each day, but cancer cells cannot. And I think this is a really important point, that in order to have a reasonable therapeutic index, there are going to need to be periods of nutrient limitation. And that if we did this in a metronomic way and there was continuous nutrient stress, then even the normal cells would be negatively affected. So this work is significant and impactful for several reasons. 893 represents an entirely new strategy for targeting cancer metabolism, going at intracellular trafficking instead of targeting individual anabolic enzymes. Because we're hitting primary and adaptive nutrient sourcing pathways at the same time, I think that this approach will limit the development of resistance. And finally, because we're limiting access to many different nutrients simultaneously, 893 should be effective even in heterogeneous tumors. And indeed, we see that cancer cells with many different driver mutations are sensitive to the compound. So our demonstration that starving cancer cells is both safe and efficacious in mouse cancer models clearly indicates that this novel approach to therapy deserves further preclinical evaluation. I'd like to acknowledge the contributions of our many collaborators, but I would specifically like to recognize Dr. Stephen Hanasian, the medicinal chemist who's worked with us over the last 5 years to develop these compounds, and also Dr. Song Kim, who's the graduate student who spearheaded this work.